Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Can you hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear.
We now move on to session four, which covers India's maritime security scenario. And it's an honor for me to reintroduce Admiral Muralidharan, former DG Coast Guard, to be the moderator for the session. Commodore Uday Rao was already given a brief on Admiral Muralidharan's credentials and his achievements in life. All I can add is that he's an old shipmate and a mentor for me. Admiral sir, over to you.
Thank you, Venu. So we come to the last session, and always, to keep the attention around after three very interesting sessions and towards the fag end of the day becomes important. But again, we are talking of the another aspects of our maritime security scenario. And we have three very impressive panelists to speak to us. So the first of the panelists is Dr. Shripathi Narayanan, who is going to speak to us about the positioning of India in the evolving Indo-Pacific region. He is a doctorate on security and strategic consideration in the Indian Ocean. He's a research scholar. He was with the Institute of Peace and Conflict Studies, New Delhi, as well also with the Observer Research Foundation. And he's been, after his basic graduation from Madras Christian College, to be a master's and MPhil from the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies of Chennai or the University of Madras. And his interest includes politics, governance in South Asia, maritime security in the Indian Ocean region, defense procurement, and of course, the Indian politics. So I would, as we know that our interests in, while we were as an ancient nation, as Commodore Uday Rao mentioned earlier, we had been seafaring for thousands of years, and our ancestors had actually had business far east into the Southeast Asia and beyond, into virtually the known world then they used to transgress. But somehow down the line, we lost all that. And then that's how when we lost interest in the sea, the Western powers came in and we got colonized. Subsequently, a lot of our scholars like K.M. Panikkar had brought about the importance of the sea, and our first prime minister spoke extensively about it. And our current prime minister in the Shangri-La dialogue talked of how sea is integrally connected to us, and also how from Indian Ocean we got to look beyond into the Indo-Pacific as such. I would now hand you over to Dr. Narayanan for his presentation.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, organizers, for having me today afternoon. I hope I'm audible and visible. Yeah, thank you, sir. So before I actually go to the topic of positioning India in the evolving Indo-Pacific region, there is first a need for us to actually define what the Indo-Pacific region is. Because the Indo-Pacific region is not a physical geographical construct, but a political geographical construct. The physical geography of the world hasn't undergone any significant change in million of years. Whereas the political geography always reflects the prevailing political mood and power dynamics. Now, the Indo-Pacific as a term is relatively new. It was first articulated by the former Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe in 2007-2008 in the Indian Parliament, and there he was giving this idea of how the Pacific Ocean and the Indian Ocean are linked. As a backgrounder to this, what Prime Minister Abe was also hinting at was that the shift of global economy from the transatlantic world to the Asia Pacific or to Asia. And if you remember, before the advent of colonialism, two of the world's largest economy was India and China, and India and China used to change places between number one and number two. Global economy was in this part of the world. That is a historical aspect. That is, but if you look at what the Indo-Pacific means for individual countries in the region, it means different things for different people. It's basically the six blind men and the elephant. And we also get confused between the term Indo-Pacific, which is a geographical political construct and the term Quad or the grouping, which is largely a multilateral forum without a specific geographical construct. It, given the overlapping of these two terms, bulk of the Indo-Pacific's focus and the Quad's focus seems to be China-centric and East Asia-centric. And even with China, given the South China Sea dispute, it takes a maritime character. In this, I will just deviate a bit. The South China Sea dispute for much of the world is seen really as a Chinese-centric construct with the Chinese hegemony and how China is subverting provisions of UNCLOS and selectively cherry-picking international norms to its benefit. But even if the Chinese are not there, the South China Sea dispute is a mess because within the other countries, they have overlapping claims. So to believe that the South China Sea is a problem created by China is overstating the obvious or underplaying the obvious. It depends as how do you want to look at it. Second is that, but with respect to India, how do we place India in the Indo-Pacific? And in this, I would like to travel back to history of the past 2,000 years. And if you really look at it, the over 2,000 year history, where there is some kind of documentary evidences in bits and pieces. India's understanding of Indo-Pacific starts from the Red Sea and ends till the Japanese coastline. It is this area where India has had some kind of trade, cultural, or people-to-people contact. If you go after, if you do a historical research, yes, there has been extensive trade ties and exchanges between this part of the world and the ancient Greek and Roman civilization, but that took an overland route beyond the Red Sea. And for India, this is what is going to constitute Indo-Pacific. That is, if you take the Americans, excuse me, their construct of Indo-Pacific is slightly divided. It largely goes at one level by their military command, the Pacific Command, what was known formerly as Pacific Command and now as part of Africa comes under the African Command. For Japan and Australia, well, Japan is largely an East Asian, Far East country. So its outlook beyond Malacca, like the Chinese, takes a similar viewpoint. It is beyond that immediate frontier. Australia is a similar case. Whereas it is India, excuse me, which pretty much sits at the pivot with almost more than 50% of our trade residing east of Malacca, being dependent east of Malacca. And our geographical location in the Indian Ocean and also our cultural, economic and people-to-people contact with West Asia, India's reach in the Indo-Pacific should be much bigger. And the reason why I'm reiterating this is because the Indo-Pacific construct, given the fact that it is a wordplay with two ocean bodies, the Indian Ocean and the Pacific Ocean, should not be limited to a maritime construct for India. And if you take in terms of China and especially BRI, India is the only country which sits bang in the middle of both the maritime highway and the continental highway. Our concern about CPEC, China-Pakistan and China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, well, that is not the only leg of BRI that is of concern. The Chinese inroads in Central Asia also dovetails into another inroad to Iran, Caucasus, Eastern Europe. And if you really look at the map from an Indian perspective, Iran, Central Asia, and to a larger extent the Caucasus are India's extended continental reach. And as someone was talking about in terms of maritime blindness, historically we have always had problems from the land and not much from the sea, except for the era of colonization. Even during the times of land invasion, much of the invasion were not from the immediate neighbors. It came from Central Asia and Caucasus, largely by the Turks or by the Mongols, descendants of the Turks or the Mongols. the second set of points I would like to make is, before positioning India in the Indo-Pacific, we should also understand what's actually happening in the Indo-Pacific. As of last week, there was a media report saying that the United States is considering to float a re-establish an Indian Ocean Command. re-establish an Indian Ocean Command, which will lighten the load of the Pacific Command based out of Japan, and they can exclusively focus on the Indian Ocean. The Germans have come out with a white paper for the Indian Ocean. The Dutch have expressed their intention of entering the Indian Ocean. The Italians have made some noise, but nothing concrete has been spelled out. In fact, the Netherlands government has come out with a white paper with a document, but right now there's no English translation available. France and UK, given their colonial position, France and its form of reunion and Mayotte, which is their sovereign territory, and they send regular elected representatives to Paris, to the French legislature, is a resident entity in Indian Ocean. Whereas the British, with their British Indian Ocean territory, which is famed for the Diego Garcia US naval base, is a resident power. So you already have way too many players entering the sea. And not to forget China with all their ports. But with respect to the Chinese ports, much of our entrance focus has been north of the equator, not south of the equator. And largely within the Asian landmarks. At the most, we think about the Chinese base in Djibouti. But if you really look at the kind of investments that the Chinese have made, the Mombasa port is being developed by China. And to supply water and electricity to that base in Djibouti, the Chinese have also tried to work with Eritrea and Somalia patch up differences with countries in that part of the world, and to supply and to have a transnational water supply. So if you really look at the kind of inroads that the Chinese are making, it does have an implication on the Indian Ocean region and therefore the larger Indo-Pacific region. The final, the third heading which I will come is as to how India sees the Indo-Pacific. And this is quite important and quite telling. If you really look at the order of things in the Ministry of External Affairs, there are two divisions that were renamed or re-christian recently. The Southern Division, which was looking largely at the Southeast Asian countries, was renamed as the Indo-Pacific Division. And the division that was looking after Sri Lanka, Maldives, India's southern neighbors, was re-christian as the IOR Division, Indian Ocean Region Division, which came out to include Seychelles, Mauritius, Madagascar, and Comoros, the other Indian Ocean islands. So here itself there's a clear-cut divide of the kind of importance or the outlook of India, is that the Indo-Pacific as a political construct as articulated by the West is one, the Quad is another entity, but for India the Indian Ocean means another meaning. So when you're going to really look at positioning India in the Indian Ocean, it is these multiple factors that will come into play. I'm sorry if my presentation sounds to be a bit disjointed, but unfortunately, given the way things are evolving, there are a lot of things that are evolving in piecemeal. And it is like a case of the chaos theory. A series of unrelated things eventually are related. Someone has to take the patience to start connecting the dots. And in this context, when you look at the Indo-Pacific region, for much of the world, the Indo-Pacific region is seen as a maritime construct with China as a fulcrum. As one of the speakers in the first session or the earlier sessions had mentioned about Marshall Plan and the evolution of politics in Europe, global geopolitics in Europe after the Second World War, it had a specific end game. And one of the reasons why the past alliance structure of the US was successful in the post-Second World War scenario world was because they had a specific political objective, which was not ambiguous, was articulate to resist the spread of communism and to put an end to communism. in today's day and age, you can't live with the Chinese and you cannot live without the Chinese. And everyone is in the series of shadow boxing. And when you're looking at a case of shadow boxing, India will be the only country vis-a-vis China where our points of disengagement will be multiple. The South China Sea dispute is important for India on principle grounds of freedom of navigation, on principle grounds of respecting international norms and systems that have been evolved, including UNCLOS, on specific grounds of protecting India's economic prospects and trade and its relationship with other countries in South China Sea, in East Asia and Southeast Asia. Our problem with China is bilateral at the border, whether it be in Arunachal or in Ladakh or in Sikkim and Bhutan. Our concerns with China is at a symbolic position vis-a-vis CPEC and the fact that CPEC transfers Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, which raises questions as to what is the Chinese position on that, on the bilateral dispute. Our problems with China is again multilateral as to the kind of support that the Chinese are extending to Pakistan. And talking about Pakistan, as a spin-off of the Armenia-Azerbaijan conflict, much has been said about Turkey and the kind of weapons that they have, cheap drones that they supplied to Azerbaijan, which helped Azerbaijan to get a favorable outcome in the conflict. But what is the nature of relationship between China and Turkey, Turkey and Pakistan, Iran and Turkey? This West Asian politics for the past 20 years at least, starting from post 9/11, is one place which is very complicated. But this is how India's position in the Indo-Pacific differs from the rest of the world. I would articulate that for India, the term Middle East doesn't exist. As an Indian, the only place I say Middle East would be in Lord of the Rings, where it was known as Middle Earth. The Arab world for me is West Asia. If there can be as a East Asia, then that this has to be West Asia. And if you look at geography in this perspective, the developments in West Asia will have direct bearings on India. And let us not forget, when you are looking at the kind of inroads that the Chinese made, the Chinese started to enter the Indian Ocean, at least the PLA Navy, only after 2008, under the guise of combating the piracy of the coast of Somalia.
5 minutes remaining, Dr. Narayanan.
So I'll just wrap up in another couple of minutes. And in this entire conversation of Indo-Pacific, when the entire focus has been east of Malacca and selective cherry-picking west of Malacca, we have completely forgotten the African coast. And the African coast is important not only for the kind of economic resources they provide to the world, but also the economic opportunities that they will provide in the future. If the 20th century is an Asian century, by default, the 21st century has to be an African century. And given the geographical proximity or location of India, we cannot afford to turn a blind eye to Africa. The final, and I would like to conclude with this one structure. Today, we have a unique position where individual countries, as I said in the beginning, the Indo-Pacific has now become a case of the six blind men and the elephant. Individual countries perceive Indo-Pacific as what they think it is. And Quad and Indo-Pacific have become a synonym, which is a big disservice because we pretty much ignore a good number of countries. And one of the questions asked in the previous session, at least that was what the message box said about Lombok and Sunda states. Well, if you really look at the one country which actually dominates the sea lanes of communication in the Indo-Pacific region is Indonesia. Lombok, Sunda, and Malacca pretty much are Indonesian territorial waters. If Indonesia as a country wishes to close these three waterways, there's pretty much nothing that can be done. And therefore, it is also important for us to actually engage individual countries in this region, acknowledge key players or players who or those who are underplaying their importance, give them that due right and due importance, and engage with them in a constructive manner. Because if you really look at it in terms of the South China Sea dispute, the North Natuwa Sea dispute between Indonesia and China came to end after the Indonesians started to burn down all the Chinese fishing vessels which they caught for poaching in Indonesian waters. One hard decision that the Chinese were willing to back down. And in terms of India, we have always spoken about ASEAN centrality in the Indo-Pacific. ASEAN centrality in a convoluted sense means Indonesian centrality, because whatever little ASEAN has achieved or not achieved has been based on the kind of backroom role the Indonesians have played, not as much as the front room role that other nations have played. And the last point I would like to say and conclude would be is that it is time for us to actually reconceptualize geography, to have a distinction between maritime and continental, between east and west, doesn't really fit or doesn't really fit India's positioning when now the world has come to accept and acknowledge Indo-Pacific as an evolving system. And in this, it is also important for us to actually acknowledge the existence of other players. It is not for, I'm sorry, I just forgot to mention this point. Along with Indonesia, what about Russia? The Russians, like the Chinese, do not accept this terminology Indo-Pacific. But the Russians are very much part of this geographical space. How is one going to engage Russia? And in this, and given this, it is important to actually start studying bilateral and multilateral and regional developments in all shapes and sizes, because everything will feed into everything else. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Narayanan. I think you have made it very clear that when you look at Indo-Pacific, you also need to look at the wider picture. And of course, we'll talk more about it as we come to the end of the session during the question answer. On a lighter vein, since you're talking of the maritime zone, may I advise you, Dr. Narayanan, I think it's very good for what you're having. Instead of plain water, the Navy talks of 60 ml of brandy and 60 ml of hot water. You have it in the evening, it'll resolve your cold by tomorrow morning. Thank you. And now we go to the next part of the session, where we are going to look at something we discussed briefly in the earlier session. We're going to have the non-traditional maritime security threats that we face and what would be India's response to it. And to cover this, we have with us Dr. Venkatraman from the Department of Defense Studies of the Madras University. We couldn't have had anybody better. He's had over 20 years experience in teaching and research in subjects as wide as foreign and security policy, human rights and development, peace and conflict studies. Earlier, he was also at the Addis Ababa University for about 10 years, and he's been a visiting professor at the Department of History and International Relations at Mexico. And he's got extensive experience and widely traveled in Africa, South and Southeast Asian countries, and in defense and strategic studies and international relations, where he graduated from the University of Madras in 1989 and took his PhD from the Center for South and South Asian Studies in 1997. And he's also been specializing in China's foreign policy. So over to you, Dr. Venkatraman, on this.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Let me just ensure that my screen is visible to all of you. Is this visible, sir?
Yeah, it's coming on now. It's coming on now. Yeah.
Coming?
Yeah, you can go to the slideshow. Yeah, okay, fine.
Right, sir. Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Very good afternoon, everybody. Very happy to be here in this important platform to talk about the pertinent issue of the, you know, maritime threats that India faces today. I am indeed very privileged and happy to be part of this particular team, this learned audience, for, you know, allowing me and, you know, accepting me to also take part and put up my points in front of you. It's a learned audience, and I've been listening since afternoon. So many things have been discussed with regard to the traditional and non-traditional security threats. A lot of things have been there. You know, we have been talking about revolving issues. A lot of repetitions are also there. Even in mine, there can be some of the points which can be repeated. So kindly bear with me if in case there are some repetitions. I must particularly thank Commodore Vasan for, you know, allowing me to be here and, you know, meet you all, virtually at least. Am I audible, sir? Is it very clear to you? Can you all hear me?
Very yes. Clear. Please go ahead. Please go ahead. You're very
right,
clear.
Right, sir. Thank you very much. Now, this is a topic in front of you. I hope you can see this. Now, before I begin to talk about the non-traditional maritime threats and India's responses to it, but I thought it'll be very interesting to show you this particular map. Well, this is not a very new thing. All of us have seen this several times. But for me, it's very, very fascinating. Very fascinating. And I want to underline and emphasize this particular scenario that we are in. You know, the central location, strategic location of India in the Indian Ocean region, both on the, you know, Arabian Sea side and the Bay of Bengal side, cutting across the Indian Ocean into two different seas. So this is the part that we are trying to look into. This is the part they're trying to emphasize upon in terms of the security problem that India faces. In fact, much of India's current rise as a major power and its role in international affairs has to do with strategic location in this part of the world. Its rise as a major power, its trade, its economic power potential has come particularly because of its location here and how much we are able to, you know, access the sea. That's a strategic location, which is a natural location that you have got. Its advantages and disadvantages too, understandably. Very much advantages because we have now come up to that particular level of developing to a very great level from what we were sometime back. But today we are now being talked about at the international politics as a major rising power, which India can no more be, you know, no more be known of. Come along with this, you know, power position of India has also come some certain responsibilities. And the responsibilities is in terms of, should be seen in terms of how much we are, you know, trying to play our role, our due role as a major power with our neighboring countries, immediate neighbors, maritime neighbors, and distant neighboring countries. So along with power comes the responsibility too, by way of, you know, providing whatever that we can think of in terms of security, especially. So this is what I wanted to see, to give us some kind of an idea, some perspective, some perception of how we are and where we are located, in order to gather some points. Now let me move on to the important categorization of non-traditional maritime threats. I have been able to categorize some 4, 5, 6 different categories. Some of them are interrelated to each other. It's not independent of each other. They're quite interrelated. Some of them have also been raised by the previous speakers, the previous panelists, the previous session. I think Commander Himadri had talked about so many things. I will not, maybe in some way it can be slightly repetitive. But then this is what I thought I'll put across to all of you. It's not new, and I'm not going to say anything very, you know, earth-shaking important points, but as I see it, I thought I will categorize them into these 6 categories of non-traditional kind of a maritime threats. The first one is about the floating armories. I'm not sure if this has been touched upon in the morning session, but this is one of the aspects that I have come across in the literatures on the maritime threats. We'll discuss, I'll try and, you know, highlight some of the points on each of these different categories. The second is on the threat of maritime terrorism. This has been raised now, and we have been talking about this since morning in different places, different ways. So I will not, I'll touch upon some of it. The third point is about the third category. It's on the illicit trafficking, piracy and arms trade, which is about the narco-terrorism. Also being talked about since morning, I guess. And the fourth one is on clandestine movement of cadres from one safe sanctuary to the other sanctuary. Movement of cadres, terrorist cadres from different places, to different other places. And the fifth is the climate change, natural disaster and the effect. The currently, what we are witnessing today, right now, in the form of a cyclonic storm, Nivar, and much earlier we have seen so many others, including the tsunamis and many other, many more, which is very, very peculiar of the non-traditional kind of a maritime threats, which I think cannot be ignored in terms of the threat it poses to people in the countries, and surreptitious movement of cadres. Now, before we move on to discussing each one of them separately, I thought I'll also bring in give some idea on the peninsula dynamics in which we are located in. We saw the previous map where the actual location is on, but then it's also important for us to see how we can differentiate, how we can divide the whole category of the threats that we are facing. One is the vulnerability of the long coastline in terms of the different kinds of villages, number of villages. About 3,600 fishing villages, maybe many more also right now. The data is slightly, a couple of years old. It's 3,600 fishing villages right now and increasing in numbers. But that's a category of, that's a number of villages that are all located along the coastlines, right from West Bengal up until the western coast of Gujarat. So many villages, which means so many different communities. Coastal communities were all settled along all along the coastline. And which shows the vulnerability, which also gives us some kind of an idea as to how much these different communities need to be protected. That's a point. And besides that, we have also got strategic installations, coastal industrialization process, special economic zones, different kinds of strategic locations are all located all over our coastal line. Again, this is not a new information to all of us, but then just to reiterate the point that this is where we are in. I mean, this is how we are located. This is how things have been located to us. And so vulnerability is our coastal areas. The naval bases are also there, Vizag, Mumbai, Kochi, and different other satellite missile launching ranges are also there. Sriharikota is one. Just before that, the chairman also pointed out the offshore and onshore coastal ranges which are vulnerable to terrorist attacks. Nuclear power installations also cannot be ignored. That's how it's also increasing, right from the Vizag coast up until the Bombay side. We have got installations, nuclear power installations, Kudangulam to many more, which are being taken up as part of our developmental activities, as part of the project of energy security, and help from other countries, distant countries, Russians and the Americans. Tarapur, Kudangulam, Kalpakkam, they're all vital strategic assets for India, and high value targets also for both non-state actors. There are several of them there, and this is how we are located now. Coming to the first dynamic, first category of the floating armories, which I thought I'll explain a little bit further. But what are these floating armories? I think these are all private security companies. Private security companies which are involved in providing security for the different kinds of fishing and also, commercial vehicles, huge commercial vehicles, carrying goods and services from all over the world. And now increasing number of PSCs, private security companies, have been employed to give security cover. They're all armed, carrying arms and weapons. And they're supposed to be having a security, supposed to be in terms of giving security to the different ships, commercial and other kinds of private ships, which are being employed to bring in goods and services. Now, most of them are basically, you know, stationed on the high seas. They are supposed to be, you know, getting into the seashore, pay some taxes, and then being checked by the local security guards, I mean, coastal guards and all that. But because of the tax money, because of the huge financial cost of, you know, getting inside and then making a check and all that, these private, you know, security companies choose to also, you know, keep floating it. You know, they don't really actually check in. They don't come into the coast and then allow their ships to be checked in. But they keep floating there so they not avoid some financial cost. And that's the biggest problem now. That's what we are trying to look at. I am trying to see in terms of posing a security. So in the name of security, it's also an insecurity factor by way of, possibility of, being supplied. These are the kind of weapon systems, weapons and armory being supplied to, you know, other people, other non-state actors, clandestine actors, and etc. And, you know, the problem of there are, legal norms and institutions which cater to checking these different vehicles, private security companies. But then the problem is in terms of, you know, how do you identify them? Some of them change their names. The ships are being changed their name. They also change their flags. And they register in different kinds of state names. So how do you check them and, you know, keep track of these different ships, etc.? It's a big question mark. So therefore, data tells us that there are violations with regard to the guidelines established by the international legal norms. IMO, International Maritime Organization, and, you know, there are many other institutions. UNCLOS rules and regulations are also there, which cater to checking and, you know, making sure that these such kind of companies, private companies, do not exceed their limitations and pose a security problem. But still, I think I must emphasize that, you know, it's a possibility of, you know, violations, you know, all that is happening. So floating armories, I think, is also cannot be ignored as one important dynamic of, you know, a non-traditional threat by these private groups of companies. Supplying weapons and carrying weapons and all that, and, you know, shipping and then, you know, transferring it to other kinds of people and vessels and all that. Now, the other is the threat of maritime terrorism and the likely targets. Seaborne jihad, and that's been mentioned previously by different speakers. Seaborne jihad, you know, Al-Qaeda, I mean, well, that's already gone, but then different names and different kinds of, you know, organizations have come about. Jaish-e Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Taiba, elite and all have come on this part. And the other side, we've got the Abu Sayyaf from the Philippine side, the eastern side. So both on the eastern and the western side, you find maritime terrorism, use of seaborne jihad as a term. Now, that's what they are trying to use right now, seaborne jihad to attack coastal facilities has also been on the rise. So this is a possibility, the threat of maritime terrorism. And the domestic use of waterborne improvised explosive devices. Waterborne improvised explosive devices domestically to be used by some of these terrorist groups who are all possible to, you know, move across and then use them against, you know, installations, coastal installations and some of our important targets. There are also waterborne platforms for conducting a standoff attack. Man-portable air defense systems attacks are also possible, which also cannot be ignored as part of the threat of maritime terrorism. Vessels, small vessels as a standoff weapon, platform providing operational security, access to targets, and a ready means of escape. So that's a very, very easy for them to, you know, quickly move out if in case they are being checked and then, you know, chased by the coastal security guards and all that. So that possibility also cannot be ignored when you look at the threat of maritime terrorism norms. And attacks by underwater drones, I think this is a point I wanted to emphasize, underline. Underwater drones are also there as technology has increased. You know, we have got airborne drones, which is also being increased. Number of airborne drones these days is becoming cheaper in terms of, you know, acquiring. So underwater drones are also possible, where, you know, you attacks, use of these kind of weapons by terrorists and then trying to, you know, come under the sea, undersea terrorist divers, and then using them for, you know, this kind of destructive means. which I think we need to be prepared, and that's a very important dynamic of, you know, the maritime threat.
Five minutes, Dr. Vic.
Yes. Sorry, sir.
5 minutes remaining.
A little more, sir. Let me just quickly cover and then finish up, sir. Hijacked vessels are also there, compromised below the waterline as a means of forcefully colliding. Use of cargo containers to act as a vector. Cargo containers. You find containers in which, you know, people are there already inside. Terrorist people who are, you know, hiding inside, you know, containers. You know, how to check them becomes a very big issue. So that can be a vector, used as a vector by terrorist groups. That is a vulnerable aspect of our non-traditional maritime threat. And which are the likely targets? The targets are already known. We have already been clearly said. It has been clearly mentioned. All along the coast, it can be offshore oil platforms. It can be oil refineries and nuclear power stations and all the other installation that we have got. These are the likely targets which we can anticipate, which I think we need to be very careful. Illicit trafficking also been mentioned in the past in the previous other speakers. Largest opium producing countries are there around the world. I mean, particularly in our neighborhood, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Myanmar, Golden Triangle and Gold Coast, they are all sandwiched. That cannot also be ignored. And the vulnerability due to this proximity, sea and the air linkages, Southeast and Southeast Asia cannot also be ignored. And therefore, the use of these different, narco means, you know, to purchase weapons and use it for terrorism cannot also be, you know, sidelined. And the money generated is used for purchasing weapons, and that's very clear. Coastline of Tamil Nadu, all along the coast of Tamil Nadu, in fact, is very vulnerable. Chennai, Coimbatore, Tirupur in particular also use drugs. So many quantity of drugs have been recently, you know, caught, and that number of, you know, such kind of catch is also increasing, which shows, you know, the problem of, drugs. Proliferation of weapons, of small arms and light weapons, which has been shifted, which has led to the shifting of regular conflicts to irregular ones of late. That has also increased. This slide tells us some of the information on the SALWs. Armed state gun runners in the Indian Ocean region is a significant threat, which is very important, which I think we need to consider also. Now, this is the other dimension of the non-traditional maritime threats. This is very, very peculiar because all countries are vulnerable to this. Climate change right now, it's happening right now. And, yesterday or day yesterday, we had the, Indian naval ship, INS Jyoti, and, one other ship has been sent for the sake of protecting our coast. That's just a very important, a response from the Indian side. This is very, very peculiar, and this is beyond the control of all the little states of Indian Ocean. But the important point is that the threat to livelihood of the coastal communities, is very much, increasing because of this climate change, which is very, very unpredictable, and a natural disaster which keeps happening now and then. So this also, I think, we need to be very much prepared for. Now, the responses, I think we need to, very quickly on the responses, I will just point out two important responses. And then two other slides. With that, I'll conclude. Responses at the two levels, I thought I should mention it here. One is on the policy level strategies and diplomatic initiatives, which India has been taking for a pretty long time. It's not that we have not been responding, we have not been preparing. We do prepare, we do have a lot of responses, we have taken a lot of initiatives, but there are certain drawbacks in this, which I think I'll point out. And the role of Indian Navy in terms of providing security to the coastal community, and preventing all these kinds of threats which I've just enumerated above. Policy level diplomatic strategies, different forums, multiple level forums, bilateral naval exercises, Malabar and Milan, we have been doing it quite often, which also ensures interoperability of the navies of like-minded countries. And we have been included as an observer status in the Indian Ocean Commission recently, in which some of the Western African countries are part of it, Indian Ocean Commission. And India is an observer status in that. India is also an observer status in the Djibouti Code of Conduct, which is a regional framework for cooperation against piracy, which is another important threat. Well, piracy has not been very much active recently, but then which the possibility of that happening again, if not in the Somalian coast or Red Sea, but in the Malacca Straits, is quite cannot be ruled out. Other aspect is the intelligence data which is being shared, maritime domain awareness, long range identification tracking system, LIRT, the SOLAS convention as part of the SOLAS convention, securing life, you know, the convention on the life at sea, which was signed in 2008 by International Maritime Organization. And sharing is very much done with countries, neighboring countries, particularly Sri Lanka. Automatic identification system has also been in place as part of the responses by policy level responses in order to ensure that new ships are being identified from a distance and they are being checked and all this. Indian Navy is another important dynamic role, playing a dynamic role in preventing such kind of threats from happening. Overall in charge, there is a picture I've got which tells us that the coastal security scheme, and 12 nautical miles beyond that is the Coast Guard, and the high seas is the Indian Navy, beyond 200 nautical miles. Indian Navy has played a very significant role in terms of creating mission-based deployments, supporting disaster relief operations in sensitive locations particularly. In the past, we have done in terms of the Operation Gulf deployment in the Gulf of Oman and Persian Gulf, and also in Malacca Straits, Operation Maldep in Malacca Straits. In the past, it has been done in 2017 and all this. But this is a very significant reaction on the part of the Indian Navy, which I think we need to recollect and keep in mind. A lot of coastal radars have also been installed as part of the responses to monitor movements and track hostile ships and aircrafts through the AIS, automated identification system and all that. But these are all in place, no doubt about that. Radars are there and all this, but then to what extent these radars and these automatic identification systems can really track, it all depends on how much the ships themselves allow themselves to be detected. There are possibilities of this detection to be removed, so then it becomes a very big difficult task. A lot of exercises, Milan, I said, naval exercises have been taken up by the Indian Navy, Coast Guard and civilian police. Intelligence grid has been done. These small efforts have been made. Procurement of weapons, bulletproof vests, and all that. Amphibious vehicles and autonomous amphibious vehicles of late have been installed, have been, included as part of the, efforts to, counter the threats from across the sea. But there are challenges, problem areas. I'll just point out a few of them and then I'll wind it up. Problem areas are both external and internal. In terms of expenditure, marine police and all that is a very external problem. The current economic slowdown because of the COVID-19 is hampering further efforts at preparedness in terms of, getting yourself updated, purchasing of latest technologically sophisticated weapon systems and keep them, updated. That's a very important part. Identifying people who are moving across the high seas and into different places. And this part of the world is basically the same category of people, same kind of people. They're all of Asian origins, and you really can't really identify as to whether they're Indians or Bangladeshis or the Northeastern people from Chinese or the Gulf and all this. Cards may be there, identification cards may be there, but these are all cards can be easily, subject to manipulation and all this. So the problem of identification still cannot be ignored. Sometime back, there was an incident in which, we were not able to do that. I'm forgetting the incident, but I think some of you may be knowing this. The coastal hamlets, internal challenge, building cyber capabilities, counter cyber threats, etc., are also a big problem area. Challenge of, intelligence gathering, collecting, processing, integrating. Although appreciable, although very much updated, but I think it's quite inadequate because you need expertise on this. Expert people should be there, but I think that needs to be rechecked and cross-checked. To what extent we are all very much capable in this line? This needs to be kept track of. Physical presence of intelligence personnel, monitoring of open source intelligence, timely analysis of data is a very important aspect. Coastal police stations, which are also involved in terms of supporting the coastal guard and all this. I'm finishing, coastal police is yet to be found. Some of them are quite functional. They are all new. Many coastal police are not so much functional. You know, the problem of, you know, personnel, the problem of, you know, economics and all this hampers the new coastal police stations, which need to be coordinated with the Indian Coast Guard and other people. So that is a little bit problematic area which needs to be addressed. Other issues are the morale of the policemen due to low salary, corruption issues, lack of periodic training. Well, this little sensitive aspect, I'm not sure whether this is this can be said here, but this is my own thinking, that there is a possibility of these things happening. We'll see it. We are witnessing in many other places internally by the same kind of morale affecting policemen because of these issues also can hamper the preparedness level, the vulnerability which can consequently happen in view of this. Maritime culture is very important aspect of imbibing people, which is very, very lacking. Port security, some of the ports do not have security at all, containers and all, etc. Now health, I don't know, this is a very challenging. I'm speaking this in terms of in front of the admirals and big you know, learned audience, but this is again my own thinking on this, the health of naval personnel, how much they are being, you know, taken care of, this aspect of psychology and health hazards because of seasicknesses and because long duration can affect their psychological thinking, and you know that aspect I think should be needs to be emphasized, and you know it cannot be ignored also. And therefore, yeah. Now to conclude, finally, this is a very important dynamic of maritime threat that we are facing. As I just mentioned, highlighted some of them, I've grouped them into some of the categories. They're quite important, very serious enough to affect our national interest. As we grow, our power position also grows, our role also grows, and the need of India to provide to act as a, you know, a very important power in terms of providing a net security provider. That's what we call ourselves, providing a net security for all the little states of India, and all the small nations look to India in terms of expecting more from India, providing net security and all this. But that's a tall claim, but are we prepared enough, to do this or not is a very slightly questionable, but we have to take some steps on this. Securing maritime zone, in a sense, is very vital. Measures are very impressive, but equally the challenges are also huge. Some of them I have pointed out the challenges. Many more have been pointed out in the previous session by some of the learned people here. The morale of the coastal policemen is very, very important for them to be uplifted, to be kept and addressed through incentives. Without them, without their cooperation, the coastal community and the integration and the coordination with the Coast Guard will not be very much effective and functional. And therefore, coordinated training is very important between the Coast Guard, Marine Police, and all of the local people should be inducted. I think this is all I have to say. This is more of from an academic perspective, not from a policy oriented perspective. I just thought I'll put across these different points. I hope it's quite some of them are very interesting, some of them are repetitive. I know this, so I ran through this very quickly. I hope it was quite very helpful. Any feedback and information on this will be much more helpful to me also. Thank you very much for listening. I'll be happy to, you know, respond to you some of the comments or questions if need be. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Doctor. What we will do is, for paucity of time, we will, you know, take on the other issues of this along with the question answer session. I will quickly move on. Please stop sharing your screen. I'll quickly move on to the next session, which it is about the, Dr. Venkatraman covered very extensively the non-traditional threats and that we could face and what we need to resolve it. And there's another threat now, which is more of the economic threat to the nation and its people. That is the illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing that happens in our exclusive economic zone. To cover this for us, we have again a scholar warrior, or should I say scholar sailor, Commander Anand Kumar, who is now the Deputy Director of the National Maritime Foundation. He's an alumnus of the National Academy of the Naval Academy at Goa and of the Defense Services Staff College, Wellington, and is a specialist in anti-submarine warfare. And he's actually holds 4 master's degrees in underwater acoustics and weapon systems, defense and strategic studies. He's an MBA in HR and an MSc in psychology. In addition, he holds a diploma in international maritime law from the Gujarat National Law University. And he's also undertaken an operation analysis and operation research course at IIT Delhi. He's currently a doctor scholar pursuing his PhD at the Gujarat National Law University. Over to Dr. Commander Anand Kumar.
Thank you, sir. Is my slides visible, sir?
No, not as yet. Aishwarya, you may like to help or project from there.
So, yes, it should be.
Yeah, okay, fine. Now it's coming.
Okay, yeah. Sir. So, yeah, fine. Let's do this exercise. What do you see on screen? You can put it in chat box. I'm sure you are seeing a tree. But in addition, can you see anything else? If you see at the base, you will be able to make out two animals. Now, what I am trying to emphasize is that when we look at something without having an idea about what I am looking, then whatever is most obvious seems to be the reality. Like we perhaps think that IUU fishing is something which is not to be bothered about in our country, in our waters. And now if we are aware of it, then also when we try to look, try to see how many horses are there. I'm sure all of us will have different numbers. And when we talk about IUU fishing and we are aware that there is, it still is difficult to identify and understand what can be the extent because there is not enough studies in this field. So let me take you on this journey. My waypoints are this. We'll be talking about global and Indian perspective, about IUU fishing, the looming threat, legal instruments and gaps, initiatives to address the IUU fishing and way ahead. Fishing is a vital source of food, employment, trade, and social well-being of coastal communities. Around 85% of fish stocked world over are overexploited, depleted, or are recovering from the depletion. And IUU accounted for around 2.6 crore tons of fish worth about 2,300 crores US dollar annually as per 2018 FAO report. The most important thing which I want to highlight is that between 1993 and 2010, 1 in 10 interstate dispute were fishery related issues because of extreme competition of depleting resource, and perhaps it may again unfold in our neighborhood that we'll see as we go along. Now, as far as Indian fishery is concerned, the key indicators are that we are giving or providing 7.73% of global share of fishery. We are the third largest fish producer. We actually keep changing between us and Indonesia, third and second position. We are second largest aquaculture producer and fourth largest capture fish producer. In 2018 and 19, there was a record production of fishery, that is 137.58 lakh tons. Exports amounted to 46,662 crore rupees, and 18% was that is a fishery, that is it is the highest share in agriculture. And fishery is contributing 1.24% in national gross value added. There are around 3,477 fishery village, and the people who are there are around 6,000 of fishermen. 6 lakhs of fishermen are under below poverty line, which accounts for around 67%. And 50% of marine production came from 5 sectors or 5 states, that is Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra, and Andhra Pradesh. Now, because the fish is over, planet is overfished, UN has come with a Sustainable Development Agenda 2030. And in that, target 14.4 of SDG 14 calls for elimination of IUU fishing by 2020. And we are talking in 2020 just to learning about IUU fishing. Being a part, it is our duty as a nation to adhere and try to achieve this. What will happen is that depletion of fish catch will lead to collapse of fishery. It will undermine sustainability, and it will also result in loss of livelihood. around 92.5% of fishing, which happens between 12 nautical miles and 200 nautical miles, are unregulated. There is no traceability and accountability of catch. There is very weak monitoring, control, and surveillance effort in terms of IOU fishing point of view. There are large fishing vessels in our EEZ. They do not have any legal framework. There are sustainability issues, and maritime and security issues also get overlapped. It's also affecting our overall economic wealth. More than 92,000 crore rupees are being lost. There is poor compliance of regional and international obligations, both by us as well as the foreign countries. And there is underutilization of deep sea resources by our own people. So what does IOU mean? These are the definitions. Illegal fishing basically means the vessels which are operating in violation to fishery laws in EEZ and high seas, both by our own nationals and foreign vessels, or without legal jurisdiction of the coastal state. Unreported fishing means all forms of non-reporting of fishing activity, which includes domestic fishing, and it is also includes misreporting and underreporting of fishing. Unregulating fishing, it is fishing conducted by vessels without nationality or flag of convenience. Contraventions to conservation measures adopted by regional fishery management organization. Now, what are the common forms of IOU fishing? This picture is basically indicating the light blue is territorial sea, contiguous, internal waters are here, then this is your contiguous zone, then EEZ, and beyond is high sea. So in high seas, whatever is happening without a flag state registration, that is then transferring of fish, flag of convenience, illegal gear, low catching. And now all these things which I have highlighted here, they are all happening within our EEZ also. Or fishing without license. Or border hopping also, like it is happening between India and Pakistan IMBL, India and Sri Lanka IMBL. Now, what are the implications? How does world view this? World considers this as a human right issue, because it is affecting livelihood of coastal population, it affects food security and global sustenance, and it also destroys the economic well-being of coastal people. It is also considered and affecting the right of livelihood and right to life as per the Article 3 of Universal Declaration of Human Rights and Article 21 of Constitution of India. But let's see how we look at it. Is it legal? I don't think, because we have not established quantum of allowable catch. And if I've not, then how will it determine if the catch which a fisherman catches is illegal? Is it mandatory to report fishing activity in our country? I don't know. What constitutes misreporting and underreporting of fishing when we have not established any rule? Do you have enough resources to monitor this unregulated fishing? Yes, of course. But government of India and state government do not view IOU fishing as a regulatory issue. But good news is that we have started talking about it. Now, this is the fishing activity in Indian waters. And if you can see my screen, these yellow dots which you see are moving here. And this is our EEZ, which you can see. Now, these fishing vessels, very easily, they can come here and they do fishing. Moreover, the fishes which are here, they do not know that there is a boundary of EEZ. So they are migratory. And these people are poaching our fishes. This light which you see, they also, during times, move out during the season. And here also you can see the amount of fishing which is happening. Now, this is one Bay of Bengal where it happens. This is how it, if you see, it is well contested by so many countries, us, Sri Lanka, Malaysia, Thailand, Myanmar, Bangladesh. And if we overlap it with our respective EEZ, we'll realize that this side also, it's too contested. And there are a lot of illegal fishing happening this side also. So what are the drivers for IOU fishing? It is weak governance structure, poor maritime security law enforcement infrastructure, adequate monitoring, control, and surveillance capability, and developing an underdeveloped economy in and around the entire IOR. Now let's see what is happening to Indian fishing vessels and how we can account for that. There are mechanized fishing boats, which are around 81% account. They all do fishing and they are unregulated. Around 17% are motorized, which account for 1,53,862. They also do in EEZ unregulated fishing. There are only 72,064 fishing, which is happening within territorial sea and which is can be said regulated now. So there is a need for regulation of mechanical and motorized vessel accounting for more than 98% of fish catch. This is another data which indicates the amount of IUU fishing. Now, important to see is that this estimate is only within less than 5 kilometers from shore. So we have not yet accounted for 195 nautical miles. This is the IUU fishing in Bay of Bengal, which is affecting, which I showed you some slides earlier, and they are almost around 756 tons. Now let's see some legal instruments and the gaps. We have talked about UNCLOS, and UNCLOS gives us effective enforcement jurisdiction. Article 56 gives us sovereign right to exploit, explore, conserve, and manage living resources within EEZ. 61 says that we should determine allowable catch. Article 62 said there should be, state should ensure optimal utilization of living resources. Article 64 says we should cooperate with through international organizations to conserve and optimal utilization of resource. And Article 73 said undertake enforcement measures. Now, if all these things are there, then why are we not achieving what we can do? Also, what are the further global initiatives? The first is moral persuasion or sanction on countries. There is UN Fish Stock Agreement. European Union started something called as yellow and red card for the fishing, which they suspect to be a product of IUU. Stopping IUU catch from entering into market, that is port regulation. Here also European Union and US are quite ahead. Then stopping vessels from landing the catch through port state measures, 2009 agreement, but we have not signed. Or stopping the entry of IUU vessels through flag and coastal state measures, that also we have not done. So what is happening is that this weak law enforcement regime within UNCLOS, and it is giving primacy to flag state, and flag states are not interested. Status of states which are not party to fishery management treaties like us, freedom of high seas, we are, but very few. And then Hugo Grotius' concept of mare liberum and inclusive interest of international community. So these all are ensuring that the IUU fishing is not being tackled the way it should be. There are other economic and political consideration. Because of that, politicians are turning a blind eye to overfishing. Some consider it as only source of livelihood. So let them do. There are political sensitivities, there are economic consideration, and the issue of dwindling fish stock is actually not bothersome to anybody. So what are our response? Too many organizations, no clear demarcation of jurisdiction. There is Ministry of Agriculture, Fishery and Dairy, Commerce, Industry, Environment, Defense, and all our major stakeholders. Everybody thinks somebody else is doing. Now let's see some regulations which are there. One is Marine Fishery Regulation Act in coastal state, which gives us requirement for compulsory registration. But remember, it is only less than 24 meters. It also decides and lays down what kind of fishing gear can be used, period of fishing, and penalties of violation. One point which I'll like to highlight here is that during the recent discussion with JS Fishery and other MPDA people, what I came to know that the states are authorized to license only vessels which are less than 24 meters, and beyond 24 meters, the central government has to issue license. And there are a lot of strong stipulations for that number of people to be there. There should be a good storage facilities. So there are people, and especially Tamil Nadu and other states, where they're making larger boats, but they're not declaring that it is more than 24 meters so that they can obviate these requirements. And there are plenty of them. Then we have got Maritime Zones of India Act 1976. We have got Maritime Zones of India Act 1981, which controls and manages foreign fishing vessels. This is the only act which is managing the fishing activity by foreign vessels. Otherwise, there are coastal regulation zone notification. There are guidelines for fishing operations in EEZ 202 and 2014. And there is one national policy on marine fishery 2017, but there is no legal backup. And I dare to stick my neck out and say, actually, we have got nil fishery regulating mechanism to take care of IUU fishing. There are other mechanisms. We observe 61 days of closure period. We have marine productive areas. We have ban on destructive fishing gears. But the constraints are, how do we implement? We have got limited manpower. There is no legal backing, and there is very poor coordination. Now there is another effort which is being taken, that is Marine Fisheries Regulations and Management Bill 2019, which has been tabled. This bill is in public for the discussion. It prohibits fishing by foreign vessel, but it only authorizes Coast Guard to enforce the law. And during one of the interaction which we had with JS Fishery, I highlighted this point that Indian Navy also should be given, like it was given after it was provided after 1981 bill as an extra addendum, which they have promised that they will look into it. And it says that Indian vessel must obtain permit to fish within EEZ, that is outside territorial sea. However, this provision is being contested by the fishing industries. There is a faulty assumption that only large fishing vessel fish outside the territorial sea. No, even the smaller vessel go out beyond territorial sea. And it also does not talk about the quantum of allowable catch. This management bill has not talked about it. So we are leaving some loopholes. Now, what is happening on ground is that there is a report of the Working Group Development and Management of Fishing and Aquaculture 2012 to 2017. That's happening on ground. What we decided was on paper. It mentions IUU fishing 6 times. The Marine Products and Export Development Authority, MPDA, it has got one dedicated page which lists the definition of IUU fishing. That's all. And Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, which has got the operational guidelines, it mentions the primary role of Sagar Mitra is to create awareness about sustainable fishery and prevention of IUU fishing. Nothing more is being discussed as of now. Now, what are the looming threat? India and Sri Lanka, Pak Bay and Kachathuvi Island, I'm sure we all are aware. India and Pakistan, Sir Creek area, we are well aware of problems happening. There is Andaman ship poaching happening. In India and Bangladesh also, things are not well at times. About Ilsa, you are aware. And in Maldives also, there are problems at times which comes out. This is there, and as the fishing resources will dwindle, as the catch will reduce, there are always a chance of flaring up issues among the neighbors. Now, in addition, since morning we are talking about China, so how can I not pick up China? So 10 Chinese vessels were found illegally fishing in Maharashtra in 20th June 19, and they got caught by chance because they were caught taking shelter during Cyclone Vayu. And these 10 boats had more than 200 crew members, and they could, this fishing vessel can catch a huge amount of fish in 1 month. And now something new has come out, which was reported on 3rd of September by VEON, which says that Chinese fishing boats are allowed to fish in Pakistani exclusive zone, and there were 20 deep sea trawlers seen. Now these people, these boats may remain within EEZ of Pakistan, but thereafter when they move to high seas, and from there, they, if they sneak out in our area, nothing, I mean, it's very difficult to stop them because they will have radar. They, on the radar, they can identify there are no naval or a coast guard ship. They will come in, pick up and go. And once they taste blood and they start entering openly, then it will become very, very difficult for us to handle it. It also is becomes a maritime security threat because it is funding organized crime in terms of international activities, tax evasion, drug trafficking. It can support terrorist activities. It is also aiding in illegal activity of weapons smuggling, drug trafficking and piracy. There are economic and political consideration, and it also has got food security challenge. So what are the global initiatives? National Policy on Marine Fishery 2017 has talked about strengthening monitoring, control and surveillance in a phased manner, providing of logbooks, color coding. Central government is trying to coordinate between state and union territory. Coast Guard and Coastal Police are being equipped, and there is a talk about engaging coastal community. There is an upward movement and interest of updating and implementing legislations, trying to be in line or with FAO and IMO provisions, and also a movement towards prevention of IUU fishing. There is a talk of... Yes, I am just finishing, sir. And there is a real craft notification which tries to do registration licensing, providing uniform web-based registration and transponders in a phased manner, and seeding of Aadhaar bank and mobile card with providing them QR-coded Aadhaar card, and this is a work in progress. Challenges in ground are that there has to be compatibility between national and state interests. There should be political synergy. There should be enlightened regional leadership, robust implementation of fishery regulation, and interministerial coordination. Way ahead, we need to have proactive creation of regional fishery management organization within IOR, carry out bilateral and multilateral treaties with neighboring state, implement port state control in accordance with FAO agreement of 2016, and infrastructure development for effective and efficient monitoring, control, and surveillance. We need to implement effective implementation of MZI Act, provide criminal penalties and confiscation of assets against national nations responsible for IEO fishing, role enhancement for Indian Navy and Coast Guard, skill development and increasing awareness of coastal community and encouraging them for deep fishing among local fishermen. And it has started in that PMSY, wherein there is assistance of 80 lakhs per vessel, which is being extended. To conclude, IEO fishing is a major threat to world peace and security. Natural resources which sustain communities through livelihood needs to be protected and optimally exploited. Otherwise, it may escalate and embroil neighbors akin to water wars. At present, the choice is not between all or nothing, it is between better or worse. An appropriate government structure, including national laws, bilateral and multilateral agreements, are the need of the hour. Thank you. And I must say, spark neglected burns the house. It is right time we put a stop on this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commander Anand Kumar. I think you have very extensively covered the IU aspect of it. We'll now take on the questions before we sum up the session. Aishwarya?
Yes, sir. Just a moment. Yes, sir. So the first question is posed to Dr. Shripati Narayanan. And the question is from Amrita Saha. The question is, do you think the Russia-Turkey five-year peace treaty executed over Armenia-Azerbaijan conflict is enough as of now, or more diplomatic efforts need to be invested so they could together together can bring more balance in Middle East and Central Asia, thereby affecting Africa more positively with due support from EU and NATO?
Hello, am I audible and visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay. I've got two answers. The short answer, I do not know. Because my knowledge of this conflict is limited to the newspaper and Wikipedia. But given the prologue to the question, so the epilogue to the question of Central Asia and Africa and NATO and Europe, this conflict should be seen, I see it as a larger context, in a larger context. Before the Armenian-Azerbaijan crisis, you had the Syrian crisis, where you had Turkey, Russia, US, Europe involved, along with the Iranis. Before that, they did during the Syrian crisis, you had the Iranian nuclear deal, where you had everyone involved. And this region has always been at a hotbed. And the Armenian-Azerbaijan conflict takes place when UAE normalizes ties with Israel. Saudi Arabia seems to be heading that way, whereas Pakistan has said an emphatic no. Along with this, you also had a couple of years ago, at least for the past couple of years, Turkey, Pakistan and Malaysia trying to create, at least Malaysia, the Mahathir Mohamad was trying to create, come with a alternative to OIC, Organization of Islamic Countries, because OIC under the Saudi refused to talk about Kashmir. And all these are actually individual issues that may not be actually linked, but given the sequencing of events and the geography and the characters involved, it begs another question, is that where does it end? What is going to be the end game? And if you really look at this, things are coming closer to India. They are no more as restricted to a specific geography as you think it is. It is no more like the Palestine-Israel question, which is only limited to the West Bank and Gaza Strip, or India-Pakistan dispute, which is limited only to Kashmir. The spillover effect comes to a much larger canvas, which also covers Indo-Pacific. And when I mentioned about Azerbaijan, Armenia in my presentation, I was not talking in terms of the conflict, but just to throw the canvas as to how big the canvas is. And I will just conclude with the last point is that in my presentation, I just made a fleeting reference to Russia. But what is also important is that the Chinese are contemplating of a northern sea route. In the future, when the Arctic ice melts, the Chinese are hoping that they can avoid the Malacca Straits and the Indian Ocean region to reach Europe and use the Arctic waters. And if the Chinese are going to actually activate the northern sea route, the Russians are going to be the game changer. Much will depend on Russia. Thank you.
Yes, sir. The next question is for directed to Dr. Venkatraman, and it's posed by Commodore Vasan. The question reads, on the specific case of MV Seaman Guard, Ohio, the floating armory which does not have any legal sanction violated our laws and was captured off Tuticorin. Yet there were many legal loopholes that allowed the owner and the crew to get away. Can you throw some more light on the legal dimensions of the so-called floating armory? And it's followed by a comment by Colonel Hariharan, and this comment is for Dr. Venkatraman. Sri Lanka Navy officially floated a company to run a floating armory. It became a scam, a big scam. These are the two. So.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Thank you for the comment from Colonel Hariharan. The comment well taken, yes, that may be the case. You're very right. I'll take it in that manner. It's a comment only. So the question from Commodore Vasan, as the literature tells us that, you know, there are a lot of, you know, legal mechanisms in place. UNCLOS clearly tells us, you know, how every particular company needs to, you know, have a particular mechanism of identifying, allowing other ships to identify themselves and then track their movement and all that, including the convention from International Maritime Organization. But that the IMO convention is only at the level of recommendations, not at the level of, you know, implementable kind of, you know, enforceable kind of thing. So it's only at the recommendation level. And then, you know, that is a basic point. If it's really enforceable, then probably you might find these private companies installing their, you know, the equipments, the technology equipments and all that, and, you know, allow the ships to be tracked and, you know, monitored and checked not for security. But that's not really enforceable. It's recommended part. So that is the biggest problem, which I also mentioned. And hence, there are possibilities of these violations from happening. I just want to, you know, say that, you know, it cannot be ignored. This cannot be ignored at all, because, you know, in future, unless it is enforceable and, you know, clearly monitored, you will also always have such kind of, you know, companies, floating armories from, you know, registering there, changing their names and removing the, you know, the gadgets and all that from not being identified and properly checked. And whether they do carry the weapon systems or not, that's really problematic. One problematic issue also happened in Enrica case sometime in 2012 or something, when the Italian Marines, you know, shot at some of the, you know, Indian fishermen, Tamil Nadu fishermen, in fact, were, you know, going there. And that became a legal issue and it went to the different courts, Indian courts and all that, and that been sorted out. They were, you know, tried and all this. So it's really a fishy thing, and I'm not really very sure as to how this needs to be tackled. But I think you should, Commodore should be telling us much more on this. But this is the information I have as for the literature goes, which I considered for this purpose. But I just wanted to say that, no, this is a really important dynamic of a non-traditional kind of a threat. I think we need to be careful, we need to be prepared along that line. That's a point. I hope this is sufficient enough. You know, if more, I would stand corrected, and I can take more information if anybody else can add to this one also. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, Colonel Hariharan has left a comment in the chat box.
Yeah.
He says, marine security companies had presented a model code of conduct for acceptance by international maritime bodies. This was ignored.
Oh, okay. Okay, comment taken, yes. Okay, I'll add up to that, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Colonel, yes.
Yes, sir. So the next question is for Commander Anand Kumar, and it's from posed by Amrita Saha. The question is, IMO is facing several issues in battling IUU phishing, especially with false and forged documentation being carried by vessels in disputed territorial waters, like the recent incidents in SCS, Gulf of Guinea, and near Galapagos Islands. What are the recommendations that can be submitted by India to IMO for better tracking and vetting of authentic vessels? The next question is posed by Commodore Vasan, the question to Commander Anand Kumar. The question reads, we have become the second largest exporter of fish and aiming to be number one, but we have serious issues with our neighbors and more so with Sri Lanka. What are the out of the box solutions to resolve this vexed issue? And on the Chinese trawlers, we need to take up this in the SAARC, though Pakistan is opposed to any SAARC initiatives, but try we must to ensure that there are protocols within SAARC members to prohibit degrading methods such as mechanized trawling close to our coasts. Another question, I'm unsure who has posted it. The question again is to Commander Anand Kumar. Sir, due to sea level rise, baselines of several littoral states in the IOR/BOB will probably shift. What would be the impact on their EEZ? Any inputs?
Shall I just? I think two are addressed to me. Can I just quickly react to that, sir, Chairman? Yes.
Okay, you can go ahead. But I think most. Okay, you can go ahead. Please go ahead.
Yeah, very quickly. I mean, one is on the recommendation to the International Maritime Organization (IMO) with regard to this kind of forgery that's possible. What is quite possible from the members' point of view? How do we really track this? That I think is a question. The recommendation that can be made is, you know, to give more teeth to IMO. You know, International Maritime Organization, you know, monitors, it regulates, it just suggests mechanisms of how ships need to be registered, different kinds of ships, you know, commercial to all kinds of ships to be registered and all that. But then some more, some more teeth to be given to IMO, so that, you know, some of the recommendations are made a little, very strict, and then, that's really a tall claim once again, but I think that's what we can do right now. And it's up to the individual countries to also ensure that, they do not take chances of, not checking but take all the precautions from ensuring that they're all monitored clearly, from not carrying such weapons and being transshipped across to other places and other ships and all that. That's the only possibility by which we can try and prevent it. That's the first answer. And the other one is about sea level rising, and that's a real happening, climate change, we are all witnessing it. That's a very big task again. It's a global effort is needed. Not only the territorial littoral states of Indian Ocean, but it's a global effort. It's not just one country, but all the countries put together should also agree to a global climate change mechanism to not ensure whatever that has happened has happened. So far that's happening already, but some more efforts not to ensure that doesn't really exceed and hamper these small states from getting submerged because of the rising sea level and all that. That's what I think I can say for right now. Thank you, sir. That's a quick reaction.
I think that question about sea level is not only about island territories going down, but it's more about how it will affect the exclusive economic zone area. So I think Anand can cover it.
I mistook it.
I think Anand could cover it in there.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Chair. First of all, it gladdens me that there is a lot of interest in IUU fishing and business of fishing. And so I will share one question, the question one, that false and forged documents in disputed territory waters in South China Sea. There are two things. One, as I told, indicated that UNCLOS is quite weak because it gives all the rights to flag state jurisdiction. So that means if China is a party to fishing militia and their fishing militia has come here and fished, and if I catch, as per law, only I can confiscate their catch, and thereafter I am to send the vessel back to that country, and flag state will take what action they want to do. So it leaves a lot of things to be desired what flag state will do. So there is a requirement wherein FO is trying to tighten that flag state responsibility, but then we are not part of it. Second is that there is a very strong movement going on to have a legal control and legally binding treaty in ABNJ and BBNJ, that is area beyond national jurisdiction, and biodiversity beyond national jurisdiction. So that means beyond EEZ, that gap which you saw, in that the world is moving towards having a legally binding some kind of treaty. So if that happens, then that area will become covered by that ABNJ or BBNJ, and within EEZ, every country will have to tighten their own law enforcing agencies to take care of this kind of illegal activities. Second, we have been question was by Commodore Vasan sir. Thank you sir, about we being second largest fishery exporter and now going for to become almost first or trying. So first was with Sri Lanka, what is the out of box issue, sir? It's a emotional question, but frankly, what is happening is that we both fishermen, Indian and Sri Lankan, we both are responsible and we both are doing wrong by going into each other's area. Now, I am glad to share with you that we I had the opportunity of having a interaction with JS Fishery very recently with our naval higher ups being there. And it came out that government in Matasya Protsahan Yojana is trying to give them large trawlers and deep fishing boats. And Tamil Nadu government is trying to provide some 1,000 deep fishing trawlers to their people. But it is on right now on paper, good intentions. But when it happens, then it will happen. So out of box is that we train our people to go deeper into sea and do fishing rather than coming remaining close. We'll have to do their capacity enhancement. The Chinese trawler, we can need talk to SAARC. It will not happen because within EEZ, the country is free. I have given license. They are doing within their own EEZ. That's about it. We will have to keep our own house in order wherein we are able to check them in case they happen to cross over to our EEZ. About baseline, sir, really, actually, UNCLOS does not give any indication. It says that if baseline is to advantage, if there is a shift, the coastal state can do that change baseline, but no time duration is given, neither it is binding. So it is all natural in human behavior. If there is to my advantage, I will definitely go for that baseline because it will extend my EEZ. But if baseline has receded, I will not accept that because then it will leave me with less EEZ. So what in the morning this thing came out that 10, 14, 40, 20 kilometers behind, and then that will become internal waters, and how do you manage? Of course that will happen. As a National Maritime Foundation organization, what we are doing is that each and every place wherever we are interacting with all the foreign think tanks, all other organizations, wherever there is a climate change or UNCLOS related discussion, we are flagging this point and we are trying to make up an idea that yes, this is a problem and this needs to be discussed well before it becomes a problem. So there is slowly awareness being done and some movement should happen in near future. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Aishwarya. Any other?
Yes, sir. So Vasan sir has posted a comment in the chat box. He says, can add more on Seaman Guard Ohio if there is time. And Colonel Hariharan has also posted two comments. One is not only Chinese, but Korean and Taiwanese trawlers also poach. And Sri Lanka fishing issue. We can license fishing on the lines of North Sea Fishing Agreement. I had discussed this when I met Sri Lanka president. He was open to listen.
Thank you, Aishwarya. I think we could request Commodore Vasan to give his views on it. The comments part of it, I will cover in the concluding remarks.
Thank you, Admiral. Basically, I thought, I'll give some first-hand inputs on this because he's closely involved with this. The Coast Guard did an excellent job in apprehending Seaman Gado Hio, and it was not operated by Sri Lanka. It actually was owned by an American company. And, you know, it's just that there were a lot of Indian crew members who were on board, and there were arms and ammunition on board. And strictly speaking, as per our MZI Act and also the EEZ regulations, they were required to declare that they have arms. That was to be checked by Coast Guard, Navy and the police. And only after that could they be allowed to operate in our waters. All these were violated. Not only that, you know, when they came off Tuticorin, they asked for fuel outside the custom limits and therefore also violating the customs regulations. So they were wrong on many counts. And of course, it became a long drawn out affair. And, you know, everybody tries to politicize these issues in Tamil Nadu. And however, I thought the crew and the master got off lightly. And there are a certain amount of pressures. I'm sure you have been DG Coast Guard and you will be able to throw a little more light on this. But I thought that, you know, the whole thing was not handled properly from our legal experts. You know, we did the same thing even in the case of Alendra Rainbow, where it was the legal provisions that let us down and not the capability of the Coast Guard or the Navy to apprehend these vessels. Over to you, Admiral.
Thank you very much, Commander Boston. I think we'll wind up this session. We already overshot time slightly, but that was expected on the first day when we have. I must first thank the three panelists, Dr. Narayanan, Dr. Venkatraman, and Commander Anand Kumar for covering the issues extensively. Now, some of the points that were discussed, but firstly, I would like to say that, yes, it's on these areas which are disputed. It is very much possible between the two countries, say Sri Lanka and India, come to an understanding that we will license fishing in that area. But this is something that has to be looked at and followed up. But the main issue is that of the Chinese fishing vessels that is coming in, if Pakistan has given it in their EEZ, one of the things that we got to mind that this is a major security threat because they could also be used for intelligence gathering. Just take your mind back to all those years of the Cold War when there were innocuous looking fishing boats of the Russian fishing vessels which was monitoring American ships and vice versa. So this is something which happened in backwaters that we need to do. Fishing into territories is a very problematic issue. I remember, I will not take names, talk to a lot of coastal chief ministers and especially of Tamil Nadu, then of the Maharashtra Gujarat coast. When the fishermen was caught going, the fishermen's unions, the leader actually told to us, sir, for last 1,000 years, our ancestors have been fishing in these waters. Today, you have drawn a line to say that this is India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka. So where do we go? But we need to bring in some regulation on this. Also to ensure the other issue that is brought out that we don't do, bottom trawling, etc., completely destroying the ecology for the rest of the fish to develop in that area. On fisheries, again, not too sure whether Anand mentioned this, but there was a Meena Kumari committee report, which is a multi-committee report, which was actually made a lot of positive recommendations on how to regulate fishing and how to revive fishing, etc. Unfortunately, it got embroiled in a political controversy, and lots of our, apart from politicians, even somewhere our environmentalists got onto it, and the whole thing got shelved. Of course, and then as far as the other fisheries coming in, illegal poaching, one of the reasons when Coast Guard was set up and when Navy used to do was that we used to have a lot of Taiwanese trawlers which used to do illegal fishing in these areas, which have now reduced, but I can't say it has been totally eliminated. So these are all areas, I think it's not a very easy solution. We need to look at it, but IOU is a very major problem. And to connect it with this, what I mentioned in passing in the morning, this should also be not utilized by them to gather sensitive data about our EEZ and other areas, which could be then exploited by them once in the technologies improve it. On the fishing again, I think this was mentioned by Dr. Venkatraman. Soon after 26/11, when we put a lot of measures into place, one of the things was to giving identity cards to the fishermen so that we could see who are the legal fishermen, etc. So the Ministry of Fisheries took up the thing of giving all handy card to the coastal fishermen. But when Coast Guard actually boarded ships and found many of them without fishing, because as usual, it was not the people from the coastal villages, but from interior Bihar and other places had actually come and started manning the fishing boats, and the boat owners found it cheaper to employ them. So these are all problems that happen. And I would also like to assure Dr. Venkatraman that seasickness is not an issue with Navy anymore. We have been living with it, and people are, I mean, I don't think it's a psychological issue. People get used to it. Plus, the fishing, the ships now are much more stable with stabilizers, etc. So the people who are actually seasick come down. Otherwise, they get used to it. So it's very much within the control of the Navy. And I think on the going into the Pacific, the very old story, actually, it's of the famous Tamil Bell, which was discovered in New Zealand good 200 years before the, that's officially reported 200 years before Captain Cook and company reached it. That's because our traders from the Tamil Nadu coast used to go far venture into it. So deeper into Pacific is not something new for us, but we'll have to now look at the geopolitics and how we are going to go about all this. And I think we had a very fruitful session. I must thank all the panelists. And I'm also glad that the number of questions that are generated, especially this being the final session of the day. With that, I would wind up and hand over to Venu, all yours.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a very long day for all of us. Before I go on to the agenda of vote of thanks, I'll take 2 minutes to cover on two important issues which came up in this later half of the presentation. First is about the floating armories. Having been involved in anti-piracy operations in MENA region for almost 8 to 9 years, the concept of floating armories actually came in when the piracy by Somali pirates increased in the region. And as an exception, International Maritime Organization permitted use of private armed guards on merchant ships for protection. But the coastal states were against permitting armed guards into their sovereign waters. So the next part was that this is how the floating armory came up. So the floating armory used to anchor outside territorial waters and remain in the area where they used to exchange the armed guards and resupply them with weapons and ammunition. So the armed guard floating armories operate out of the territorial waters well within the gambit of existing rules and regulations, and they have their registration and they have their flag as well. Only Gaul in Sri Lanka used to permit the change of armed guards around. And that's one clarification which I wanted to inform the esteemed audience. The next part is about the kind of excitement which has come up after US Secretary of Navy Kenneth Braithwaite mentioned about the first fleet. Well, the geographic jurisdiction of the first fleet would remain between the 7th fleet, which is based at Yokosuka, Japan, and the 5th fleet at Bahrain. And the other support base for the US is Diego Garcia, along with Singapore, but it's a logistics agreement. The agreement does not permit permanent basing of First Fleet. So it is coming up in the strategic forums in US circles that the First Fleet is going to be an expeditionary force based on reallocation of resources from other fleets, and they will operate as an expeditionary force in the region without permanent basing facilities. Their bases in Diego Garcia, their logistics base support facility in Singapore, that is in Changi base, Changi and Sembawang, and also the agreement with India, Limo, which can also permit replenishment of these ships operating in the region. So the First Fleet is unlikely to have a permanent base in the region. Having said that, I will go on to the formality of the vote of thanks. It's been a great day with brilliant presentations from all panelists. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the speakers as per the descending order that they arrived on the mic. Dr. Vijay Sakhuja, Captain Nitin Nakarwala, Commodore Gopal Suri, Commander Arnab Das, Professor Rajaram Nagappa, Dr. Venkateshan, Admiral Muralidharan, Captain Himadri Das, Mr. Sandeep Unnithan, Dr. Sripathi Narayanan, Dr. Venkatraman, and Commander Anand Kumar. I also take this opportunity to thank Mr. Shashi Nair for kicking off the day's proceedings, and also to thank Commodore R.S. Vasan, Professor B.M. Chengappa, Commodore Uday Rao, Vice Admiral Muralidharan for chairing the sessions, and the support team of all for their wonderful assistance in the control. Last but not the least, a big thanks to a very patient audience and for the active interaction. Thank you. Have a great evening. Be safe.